Hey there, it's Antrice, and welcome to another episode of the Savvy Painter Podcast. Savvy Painter is the podcast for painters who know that mastering your craft is a lifelong venture. They understand that the hardest part is showing up every day, whether they're inspired or not, and that we're all in this together. For the past 3 years, the Savvy Painter Podcast has been sharing tips and techniques that you can use every day in your studio. And when you join the Savvy Painter email list now, you get a collection of inspiring quotes and practical advice collected from years of Savvy Painter interviews. Just go to savvypainter.com/subscribe to sign up for weekly emails and get your free PDF, Essential Tips for Artists. Each week, I interview established artists like Ann Gale, Scott Connery, Rebecca Crowell, and many other artists who are willing to open their studio doors, share their painting processes, and talk candidly about what it takes to consistently grow your skills. We get into the nitty-gritty of their daily studio practice, what tricks they play on themselves to avoid getting caught up in perfectionism, how to use flashcards as reminders to stay on track during long painting sessions, and other cool tactics to quiet the inner critic and continue moving towards excellence. The Savvy Painter Podcast is filled with artists who generously share their stories, and by sharing their stories, they show the rest of us that we are not alone. So join us with the Savvy Painter email list and get even more connected with weekly emails. Sign up now and you get Essential Tips for Artists, the inspiring quotes and practical advice collected from years of Savvy Painter interviews. Go to savvypainter.com/subscribe. It's that easy. Peter Fiore is my guest this week. He's a landscape painter living in northeastern Pennsylvania. Peter is obsessed with capturing light. And he goes to great lengths to research his current series of paintings, large-scale portraits of trees that he encounters in the woods around his home. Peter has won a number of awards for his work, including first place for landscape in the Art Renewal Center's annual salon, as well as receiving a grand prize in the America-China Oil Painters Artist League Open Competition. Whew, that's a mouthful. In this episode, Peter talks about how his early work as a photographer helped him learn to compose a painting. Peter almost stalks his subject before he begins, but that part of the process is both essential and he obviously enjoys it. He talks about the intense research he does in the field before he even starts a painting and how he orchestrates that experience into his large-scale paintings.
Great plein air painting is like a great song. Really a good song. But you know what? I want a symphony. I want an orchestration to it. I want to be able to take it and evolve a painting in the studio where I can glaze, I can abrade the surface, sand back. That to me is the full language of a painter.
As usual, this is a wide-ranging discussion. I wanted to know everything about his painting experience, including what music he listens to while he paints and why. Turns out, Peter's very particular about that, which I loved. For Peter, being comfortable in the studio is paramount. Peter's enthusiasm is absolutely contagious. I hope you enjoy his stories as much as I did. So, ladies and gents, here is Peter Fiore. Peter, thank you so much for being on the Savvy Painter Podcast. I'm really excited to talk to you today.
And so am I. This should be interesting. I'm looking forward to it, and I hope that this will be entertaining as well as informative.
Can you tell me a little bit about when you started out as an artist? I'm kind of interested in any stories you might have about your first painting that you were really proud of, or artists that really resonated with you and inspired you.
Well, there's a couple of questions right there. You said when I first started out thinking about being an artist, or the beginning of my world as an artist. It really was about photography first. I was very much caught up in that world. Matter of fact, I got a partial scholarship to go to Pratt on a photography scholarship. And what happened was, when I was a young kid, my dad brought home a camera, a German Zeiss rangefinder camera. I was about 10 years old, and he handed it to me and said, "You're home for the summer. Why don't you try to figure this out?" So I went to the library the very next day, took out a couple of books on photography, and that's where this started. And then became very serious about the photography. As a matter of fact, that's what I wanted to be. I wanted to be a Cartier-Bresson. Travel the world out of a bag. But the only problem was the Vietnam War was going at that point.
Mm.
and I would have been there. So that wasn't why I changed it. But what had happened was by the time I was in college, I had done 7-8 years of serious photography where I had large format experience. I knew reciprocity charts. I knew all of this stuff. And then the chairman of the photo department said, well, we can make you deeper in what you do, but you basically know all of this stuff that our seniors don't even know yet. That kind of thing.
Oh, wow.
So it was that kind of level. I had a really strong portfolio. It was very journalistic. And I said, you know, and I think I will go into illustration. The reason it was illustration, because it was something I always liked to draw and paint as well.
Mm-hmm.
My dad went to art school, but never had the chance to do anything with it. So when I was a little kid, he would sit down with me, help me draw, and help me show me perspective. And that was like, oh, that opened the world to a new dimension. It was like, you can make the picture go into the plane. That was like exciting.
Yeah.
So I learned that, and that was amazing. And then coupled with the photography, which always was an aid, my illustration career took off while I was in school because I could draw, and now aided with the photography. I was doing quite well. I actually started promoting my work while I was in school, my senior year. And the very first assignment I ever got commissioned was for a double page spread in McCall's magazine, women's magazine. And in those days, that was like big editorial work.
Yeah.
In the mid late 70s. And they paid me a phenomenal amount of money for that piece. It was like literally $2,500. Now today, in today's world, you extrapolate what that is. No one gives a 19-year-old kid that kind of money to get started for their first job. And that's when you asked about the painting that I first did. That was the one that made me a professional artist. Was that while I was in school, I got paid in a major magazine where my heroes were being published. So that was like mind-boggling. That was like, wow, that's like I didn't think I made it, but I think I hoodwinked them more than anything else, because every artist lives with that. You know, it's like when you start to make success and you start to, I can sit in my studio every day and make paintings. It's like someone's going to come tap on your shoulder and say, all right, Fiore, we've been watching it. Time's up. Tomorrow, you're working on the dock next week. Get report down here. Dock 72, you're unloading boxes for the rest of your life. That's what you feel like as an artist.
Yeah, somebody's going to find you out. Oh, and that this is just too good to be true.
That's right. And that's the greatest thing about art, is that it's allowed me a tremendous life of a lot of freedom, a lot of happiness, a lot of joy, making my own world. And boy, oh boy, you know, it's like, no, you don't get the most money of other people, but you want to know something? I have the time to enjoy my life. And
that's huge.
That is huge. My house is paid for. My kids are out of college. And, you know, life is good.
Mm-hmm.
So now we just keep painting.
I love it.
So that's how it all started. Very young. Very young, at 19 years old.
Wow. That is very young. And that's an amazing story. But I'm curious, can you tell me a little bit about how your photography helped you out?
Design. Composition. I walked around. My aunts and uncles are all gone now, but they used to talk about how the camera, they never saw my face. My camera was always up in front of my face. And I basically looked at every event, everything with people, wherever I went with the camera, looking through that viewfinder. In those days, it was 35 millimeter film, 36 shots in a roll. So I had 36 opportunities to make a picture. Mm-hmm. And you know what? When you get used to looking through that viewfinder, you learn to see the world quickly. It's already the parameter of a frame. So I learned how to see. I learned the idea of viewpoints. I learned all of that stuff. And that's always been very second nature to me, composition, shapes, how they – and because of part of that, and coupled with a lesson that I had in art school, is why a lot of my paintings are high horizons and a lot of ground planes.
Yes.
That's because an instructor – at school, they didn't teach painting per se, because at that time, there was non-objective painting that was being done at Pratt. And it was all big color field painting. And I wanted to paint the figure. So I made him get me a model. And I was the only one out of 30 people in the class working from the model. So I had to set up the model and pose it and light it and all that. Everybody else was doing their thing. And then one day he comes over to me. He cleared half the classroom and he put on the floor, moved all the easels and tables away, and put 18 by 24 inch sheets of newsprint on the floor. some overlapping, some, you know, spaced out, going from maybe about a 20-foot depth. And he goes, draw that. Draw that, what that looks like. And because you'll know right away, if your drawing is off, that corner of that paper is going to flip. It's just not going to sit down. And then I learned how to construct a ground plane. And that has been so much a part of my life in terms of how I see things. As a matter of fact, the very first painting I did for McCall's magazine was raised as a Catholic, right? The very first assignment I get is, why is this night different than all others? A Passover thing. And I had to do a Passover table, people sitting around the table. So I chose a high viewpoint. Looking down, I made the table the star. And around the table, I put in everybody holding hands around the table. So I played up a white linen with white dishes, white napkins, and it was all tones of light values with candlelight dappled across that. And that was my very first illustration. Again, it wasn't the ground plane, but it was a ground plane in the sense that I elevated my to make it the ground plane.
Right.
Of looking down on. Always enjoyed that perspective. And it all comes from looking at those pieces of paper and successfully bringing the eye from front to back. I enjoy taking people into painting like that.
That makes a lot of sense because your paintings are so, I mean, first of all, they're incredibly intricate. So I live in the mountains. I live in the woods. And so I'm always walking and looking at the woods and going, I have to figure that out. But, you know, I'm not there yet.
I understand.
You've taken something extremely complicated and just made it.
Well, I call a lot of my tree paintings the tangles. And everybody's gone, you've walked in the woods and, you know, you're walking and just for a walk, without any idea of doing anything other than taking a walk. And it's dark and shadowy and the light is hitting things and you really can't figure out where branches are because things are all over the place. I love making order out of that. That to me is exciting, making visual order out of chaos. And it's really making something representational as something very abstract.
Yeah.
Mark-making. It's marks. That's what I enjoy. The marks, how the paint goes down, the texture, just happens to be a picture of something. It's about as far as I'd like to go totally to abstraction. I still want to hang it on something.
Right.
And that's how I'm doing what I'm doing now.
Interesting. How long have you been working on this series?
The series of trees, I actually started thinking about it at the end of 2009 and didn't really start in 2010. And the reason that came about wasn't so much about the tangles. It was in a very big car crash in 2008, the first paintings were made in 2009, 2008, November. I was in a car that flipped 6.5 times and it busted my back up and I tore my rotator cuff, my right rotator cuff, broke all the ribs. And I really couldn't paint for a long time. And so what happened was I'd go to walk in a national park on the Delaware River here, where we live. And I used to look at these trees and I remember looking at one in particular. And then the springtime had come and they did a burn off. The government did a burn off to stimulate growth. And my tree that I had been looking at was now scarred, blackened. I did a painting of it blackened. Anyway, I looked at this tree and I was horrified. And then in time, as I kept going back, things were growing stronger all around it. It was the tree growth. The vines were growing up this tree. The tree was growing more lush. And it became a symbol or metaphor for me in healing about my life. And that's exactly what this whole tree series started with. And then the first part of it was the White Pine Suite, which is made up of three parts, the cathedral, the seasons, and passage. And there's three different sections to that. And it's a spiritual thing. I'm not a religious guy at all. Very spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
But walking in these pine forests, and in the wintertime particularly, where there are large canopies of these pine trees, snow on the ground, it's a very quiet and still place. And it's probably one of the most solemn places that I've ever been. It's like you hear your heart. Footprints squeak, nothing else because of the snow in the trees dampens all the car noises and everything from the, you know, in the quarter mile distance away. And all of a sudden you look at the light coming through, just filtering through, and you look at this, it's absolutely a timeless forest. It is. And I say this, it's like, is it, it could, you know, I'm here I am today, but is it 10,000 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
Could be 10,000 years from now. Mm-hmm. It's like, there's nothing there to say anything else. And it's just a wonderful thing to have that be an essence of what I like to paint. I want to paint things that speak to eternity and speak to immortality. Because that's why I don't put things of time in my paintings. I'm not interested in that. I paint as a 21st century, late 20th, 21st century painter in the manner in which I paint, but I'm painting about something grander, something hopefully that is timeless. And if it's timeless, things speak to people in many different ways and for a long time and forever, hopefully. And because it's about the way the world is seen, it's also the language anybody could understand. I teach at the School of Visual Arts. I have a lot of students that are exchange students. Most of them are Chinese students. And I tell them, I teach about light. I said, this is universal language. You paint and understand this. Everybody in the world understands the one light source called the sun and the way the atmospheres are created and the light and filtered light. Everybody knows what that looks like. And if you can understand how to harness that and even tweak that and then start to make moments that are eternal, like something that's felt, as opposed to spelling out. Other people feel that too.
Yeah.
You're not so unique that we are alone in this world that way.
Right, right. You're reminding me of this study. It's been a very long time since I've read it, so I'll have to paraphrase it, and I'll probably get some of the details wrong. But I think it was a psychology study, and they were looking at how to alleviate modern stress and, you know, like all the things, all the overload that people experience. And what they discovered was that people who walked in nature, who walked in the woods.
I have read an article about that.
Yes. And their
stress go way down.
Way down. Like it's a dramatic.
Yep.
Difference from people who are, for example, in the city. So even if you're in the city, you can just go to a park and walk on the green grass. It makes a huge difference.
Oh, sure. Well, you know, we are creatures of the earth, not of buildings. We're not of cement and glass. We're fields, sand, snow, mountains, rivers. That's where we inhabit. Animals are. Animals are not in cities unless they're pets, right? Or zoos. And that's their natural habitat. That was our natural habitat. We sort of outgrown that because of civilization. But those are the things that reset our clocks and reset our hearts. At least I think it does. For me, it does. And because of that, that was always been a part of my thinking and had been for a long time. And that's when, at the age of 30, even earlier, I'm now 61, going to be 62. When I was about 30 years old or so, I wanted to get out of New York City. I'd had it. I'm done with New York City. So I looked in Pennsylvania, and that's where I settled. And I found some property that I liked, not far from highways and all that, but where I can get into New York if I need to, which I do. But as far away as I can be from New York with still being within an hour and a half by car.
Mm-hmm.
And it's amazing. And it's also developed my vocabulary for painting of what it is that I do. I live in the subject I paint. By seeing it constantly, I'm always informed by it. It's not like I have to go, intellectually think that what does that, what can that be? What can it look like? I go out and look. I go to the same spot 5-8 times a week if I need to look at it at different times, look at it in different weathers, different times of the year. Many times I'll go to visit. Sometimes I'll visit a place 30-40 times before I even lift a camera to figure out what it is. I have to learn what the place is. That's why travel painting, I don't get that because that to me, I don't know the subject. I'm looking at it, but I don't know that subject. I don't have a handle on that. So like, I don't understand, like portrait painting, for instance. If I were a portrait painter, I would want to know the subject, not just a photograph of the subject that I'm painting. So that's kind of that thing. I have to learn what the subject is, understand it. And it takes time.
Yeah, it does. Can you talk a little bit about your process? I'm kind of, and I'll ask you this again later so you don't have to remember it, but I'm asking because I'm really curious. You've touched on it a little bit, but you've been working on this series for almost 10 years, right? 2008. So,
well, yeah, I guess so. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. It's closing in.
Yeah. It's closing in. Isn't that amazing? Wow. Well, the very first painting I did of that really wasn't until early 2010. So it's 8 years. It'll
eight
be
years.
8 years.
Okay.
8 years that I actually did the first painting.
Okay.
I did a lot of studies, but nothing major.
So this might be partly addressed in your answer of process, but I'm curious, like what after 8 years. What is it that still fascinates you so much about these paintings, this subject?
I think the subject of, well, trees have always been a stand-in for people, always for me. Okay. And I remember as a kid seeing, you've seen them on the side of roads, highways, where someone has hit a tree and they died and they anoint the tree with wreaths and all of that. That always intrigued me as to someone lost a life, but they're remembering that. And trees have always, in the pine trees that I paint, these white pine trees, are very people-like. They're not oak trees, they're not elm trees. They have these limbs and arms that go out and they just reach out and they have like a quality of them that are very much people. So to me, there's a painting I sent you. It's called The Rising Sun. That was the tree that one of the first ones that I saw that was a presence as opposed to a tree. I remember coming out of the dark woods, turning to my left, and I saw that tree with that light. The color wasn't what I saw, but the light was what I saw. Okay. Mm. So now all the color is reorchestrated and heightened to give you the feeling of what I felt. See, I'm not painting what I see. I'm painting what I want you to see. So I have to, that means I have to reorchestrate, manipulate, color harmony, all of that stuff changes to get it to strike an emotional chord that I want. And that's really an abstract kind of idea. Well, I'm not painting realism. I paint realistic things and what light does, but I'm trying to do more than that. That's why plein air, for instance, I've done it. I enjoy it, but it's, I'm going to make a music analogy. A great plein air painting is like a great song, really a good song. But you know what? I want a symphony. I want an orchestration to it. I want to be able to take it and evolve a painting in the studio where I can glaze, I can abrade the surface, sand back. I can, that to me is the full language of a painter.
Right.
For me, that's this. You know, gotta understand. Whoever listening to this is my opinion only, because that's all I can talk about.
Right.
That's all I can ever talk about. And I don't mein to say I don't like. For me, plein air painting is not interesting. It just isn't. I'd rather stand there for 2 hours and look, and rather than paint, because I'm painting, I'm so concerned with the surface, I'm not looking at the scene evolve. I'm concerned about the painting, and I don't want to be. I just want to stand there and look. Mm. So that's part of the process, the looking, hunting for the locations. Often I'll go out in the middle of the day when the light is miserable, and I'll look for motifs, and I'll have a compass with me. And the compass will show me east, west, where the sun comes up. Will this be a good subject at early light, or is it in the west where early light will be good on it, or late light, or that kind of thing? Then I go back, and then I look at the weather charts, see what weather's going to be, what days are going to be. And then I educate yourself to a location. I put it in my GPS. And I go back lots of times, early morning and late afternoon. So middle of the day I'm painting, early morning I'm out, usually late in the day I'm out. In wintertime specifically, at a much greater pace. Because in the summer, it's less interesting because it's everything looks like a broccoli plant. Everything is the same. It's like everything. It's like trees are invisible in a sense because their structures are not there. I want the bones. I want to see the anatomy of that tree. That's the person.
Interesting, because I would, so just, you know, again, from as many walks as I've taken in the woods, right. I would kind of say that in the summer, well, you're dealing with pine trees, so you don't really have that as much of a leaf fall
right.
issue.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
Okay. Now I'm getting it.
But there are trees around them that hide them quite a bit.
Got it. In
wooded areas, it can be like that. Because, you know, but pine forests are amazing year-round. Because then you get different kind of light in there. You know, you get, like, the ground plane becomes the spotted, like little spotlights all over the ground. And limbs catching. That's exciting, too.
Yeah, and you got the reflection of the snow.
The snow is amazing in the woods. What's interesting about the snow is dependent upon what the sky is doing. Whatever the sky does is going to reflect on the snow. So if you've got a warm sunrise, you're going to have warm snow. You got cool sky, you're going to have cool snow in the shadows. So those are things you look for. And those are the interesting things to play. Snow is just not one color. It's like whatever's going on out there.
Yeah. It's like tofu.
Yeah. There you go. One of my favorite painters, one of my favorite, George Innes, you know his work. Okay, look at his snow paintings. His snow paintings are anything but white. There's no white snow.
Right.
They're everything in the world. Right. And that's what I love about all this. And it's there's a lot of theory in this stuff. At school, I learned a lot about color theory by studying. We did our first year interaction of color by Albers, Joseph Albers, right? Uh-huh. And one of my teacher was a student of Albers at Yale. He did his MFA up there, I guess, in the late 50s, early 60s. So that was the big thing that we did. We did color theory, right? Uh-huh. Now, I was really good at that. With color aid paper and all that.
Oh my God, I love that.
Well, you make two colors, make two different colors look like the same color,
yeah.
Make the same color look. And I said, that's great. I'm going to say his name because he's one of my favorite teachers. Hey, Mr. Bierman, this is terrific, but what has this got to do with my tube of paint that says cadmium red over here?
Right.
Didn't pick up a tube of paint that whole year, that first year. We did color aid paper the whole year, and it drove me out of my mind. I understood the theories, but I didn't know how to make that color.
We had to do it with gouache. They had us doing it like a full semester, just gouache.
Where did you go to school?
I went to Art Center College of Design in Pasadena, California.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah, and so we did those same color theory things, but I think maybe, I don't know, now I'm wondering, were they trying to, because they were really big on craftsmanship.
Yes.
And so I think they were kind of trying to combine the color theory with
practicality.
Yes. With, you know, like get your corners down perfectly, tape it off, make it exact and no yeah. streaks and no, you know, like it had to be perfect.
What was your major, if you don't mind me? What was your major?
Illustration.
There you go.
I had illustration fine arts. So tell me more about once you have done your reconnaissance, what happens next once you've decided?
Okay. After I've decided a motif, I found a motif, I have to go look and visit this thing many times to find out, you know, is it early light that's good? Is it overcast light? Is it different times of the day kind of light, weather? Certain subjects will look better in certain lights, right? Then I discover what that is. Then if I figure that I want to make a picture about that, I will go back until I get the light that I want. That may mean in the wintertime, and I'll have to, there's a window of light and some of these things that's only there for 5 minutes because there's a tree line that's behind you that's going to take, you know, you got to know when that sun's going to hit there. So you got to look at the sun charts and elevations and all that and make sure you're there.
That's intense.
And you have to be there ahead of time. You just can't go there when it's happening. You got to be there an hour in anticipation of what's going on. So you got, what does that mean in the winter? You got to dress very warm because mm-hmm. you most of the times you're going to be standing in the shadows.
Mm-hmm.
That kind of boots, so your feet don't go numb.
Mm-hmm.
Thick, several, you know, glove liners with mittens so you can get your finger out to take the pictures, that kind of stuff. So it's a job. It's a job.
And are you figuring all that out through charts and data, or do you go and just watch and go, okay, at this time?
Right, I do that.
Okay.
I learned that over the years. I know a particular tree that I've been painting that the best light is in the early December, mid-December at 3:05 in the afternoon because there's an opening in the trees, but they're filling up now because they're growing. So it's becoming, the aperture of that opening has become smaller. So it's no longer as grand as it was in like, say, 4 years ago, but I'll see what it is in this December. We'll see. You never know. Sometimes branches fall and open things up. That's another thing that nature does. Trees come down. Limbs. I have a tree, an apple tree that I've been doing a series on that its main limb that I love to paint collapsed. So now that it's been all taken away. So now it revealed another part of the tree that I couldn't see before. So that's interesting.
Yes.
So, you know, apple trees in winter are great. In the spring when they're blossoming, they're everywhere.
Yeah.
They're everywhere. It's like this. This is what you're painting. This is what you're painting.
It's like arthritic hands that have got yes. all these knobs. And
in the spring, you've got all these blossoms. So they got all this stuff breaking up the shapes and leaves. And if the light, and this is great, I love the light coming from behind me so that it's flat. So it's just temperature and color change.
Oh, fine.
And that's another way. And that becomes a color field painting. It's not about form. It's not about rendering form dimensionally in space as it is patterns of shapes. The base of the tree will be the trunk and light against shadow, but the whole top of the tree is just very flat. I think I sent you one.
Yeah, I think you did. And I remember, and it was really, yeah, it was very flat and yeah.
Yeah, and that's one of the things I love doing. That's another thing I like. There's all these different things, many ideas I have, which are great because I'm not going to run out of material. There's a lot of things I want to do.
Right.
So it's good.
So you've got like down to, it sounds like the minute of when you need to
yeah, minutes.
to
yeah.
snap that photo.
But you got to get there ahead of time. And then I start photographing ahead of time, because sometimes you get surprised with a piece of light coming in randomly, that if you're waiting for the ultimate light, it may not be as good as what you got randomly. Mm-hmm. You got to be open for that, because nature throws you curveballs. A cloud comes in, or the sun hits a part of the tree that you never thought that would be an interesting composition. But you got to be open to it. So it is a spontaneity as well to it. But being ready for it makes it all happen. If I just happen to be walking down the street and say, oh, that's a nice shot, click, I don't know anything about that location. I have no connection to it. I don't fall in love with the space. So it's like, it means far less to me. It's not really all that interesting to paint. That's why commissions are tough. And traveling to, you know, when you go on vacation to try to come back with material, doesn't work. Just enjoy the vacation. It doesn't work. it just does not work for me.
I think it depends on how long you're able to stay there and whether or not you're,
Right. I would love, you know, ideally, I would love to go to Sicily, where my ancestors are from. My dad was born, and hang out for a year or two. That would be ideal. It's not going to happen. Right. But that would be ideal. That would be ideal, because then you learn what it is to be there.
Right.
And you learn what it is to breathe that air, see the light, understand the light, because the light and the atmosphere of a place infuses the culture there too as well. Mm-hmm. And like up here where we are, it's a very outdoorsy kind of place, right along this national park. And there's a lot of, you know, this is an area where a lot of New Yorkers and people from Bergen County, New Jersey come for winter skiing and also cross-country skiing. And in the summer, canoeing and kayaking down the river. So it's there's a lot of that going on. But it's a beautiful place. That's what got me here. Mm-hmm. It was the fact that it was the country and without any hint of city. And it's still like that, which is kind of interesting, good and bad, is that the bad thing is that I am like an island here as far as art goes.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of it here.
I think I'm living in the California version of where you're living. I'm literally half a block away from a ski lift. Exactly the same, like the forests and the ski resorts and then the lakes and the canoeing and all that. It's all here.
Yours is much bigger mountains. We have foothills compared to what you have.
Yeah, our house, I think, is at the 8,000-foot level. So we get an enormous amount of snow. So now you've been there, you've got your photos. What happens next?
Right. Now I've got my photos. Now I got to do a major edit. Now, photography is digital photography today. So, which is really good, because although I used to blow through lots of film, but that's not a concern anymore, the price, right? But the time, you got to edit it all. And I don't throw away anything stupid. I have terabytes and terabytes. I must have 100 terabytes worth of photos from the last 8 years. And I just edit this stuff. And I just go through it, look at it, throw stuff in a maybe folder, stuff that I'm not going to use, keep it in its original folder. And then I go back at it and look at it. And then because I shoot raw files, mm-hmm. I will go back and I'll do one as natural as I can remember the scene to be. Just have a base to see what that looks like. Then I save that. Then I'll open up the raw file again and I'll start playing with color. Start looking at value structure. Start looking at what that can be or what it can be or whatever. And then play with that and then see what it gets. Now, that doesn't mean I'm not talking about saturating color. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking more about shifting color, mm-hmm. like temperature balances, like warmer, cooler, and then things like when you cool off something and then maybe go in and just saturate a warm channel of something. And then all of a sudden, you've got areas of interest involving in the painting. Photography is as much a tool as a palette and sketching to me. Mm-hmm. And then once I've got all of that, and then I start making some smaller paintings. If it's a motif I've never painted before, I will do paintings like, you know, 16 by 20, 18 by 24s. I use those, I call those sketches, because I need a big enough painting so I can make the mark that is what I'd like to make. Because the kind of mark I make will tell me if it will be a successful picture for me. It's just not getting the color down and the composition down. I have to understand the structure of the painting. If I can make the study give me some of those clues, then I have a better idea of where I'm going or what I want to do. So that's important. So in reality, the beginning of interesting painting to me is like 30 by 30. Mm-hmm. Like that scale and then up from there. Because I just enjoy making large paintings. And they're fun because they go quicker than small paintings for me. They're very explosive. They're very big brushes, big, more paint, and it's much more energetic. And that's where music comes in handy too. I have certain playlists that I have for the beginnings of big paintings.
You do too. Okay, tell me.
Absolutely. Okay. Now, a big painting needs to have a demonstrative beat to it. It's got to have power behind the music. It's got to feel, and like now Beethoven is good for this because it makes me, like a lot of his pieces, you feel heroic. You feel.
He gets that explosive.
Right. That, yeah. It's heroic. You feel like an emperor when you listen to the music, the way it makes you, it just gets your blood moving and all of that. And that, but then right in that same playlist, it's not the music, how it works together. It's how it works in my head. So I can write in that same playlist. I could have Talking Heads in there and the Clash, because that gets me in the same place. Not how it sounds who's listening. It's me. It doesn't matter to me who else is in the room or what else they think about it. It's not going to be, it's not like I'm hosting a music show. It's where it gets me, you know, what it does for me. It's to maintain a certain level of energy.
I love this. And this is going to be a really weird question, but headphones or no headphones?
No headphones. I can't stand
really?
Headphones. Not when I'm painting. Oh, no.
I'm the exact opposite.
Now, I'll tell you why. Because the headphones is, I feel like there's something, I'm not in the real space. Headphones, eyeglasses are something between me and what I'm doing. If I hear the music as in the environment, I'm in a space. It's not my headspace, it's the space.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Does that make sense? It's
yeah.
The environment of the student. Now, my studio, what is it? It's 22 by 30 feet and lofted up, so 16 feet up. So it's a little bit big. So when you listen to music, it really, really resonates. And it's got a really rich sound. And you can hear it probably in the next property. If they really listen, they can hear Peter's making a big painting again. But yeah, you can hear it. And I'm sure you can. My wife, Barbara, says she can hear it, the beat of it. The beat of what I'm up at from in the house. So yeah, but that's important to me.
Uh-huh.
Learned a long time ago, the studio is an environment. It's a palace. It's yours. It should be what you make it to be. Temperature wise, music wise. I have a Keurig machine because drinking an espresso is important to me. I got to do that. That's
yeah.
important. Whether it's, you know, yeah, the caffeine or no caffeine, whatever, but that's important. Being comfortable in the studio is paramount to making great stuff. And that's another thing I don't like about working outdoors. There's nothing comfortable about it. You see this here? Look at this. See these nostrils? They take in a lot of bugs in the sun. I don't need that. It's not fun. It's like, and also being of Italian descent. See this? I got a lot of hair. And it's like, and on humid days, it starts to curl.
Right.
And it makes me feel like I'm bug covered. As my family is not a summer people. We, even though we're from a little island in the mountains of Sicily, they don't have the kind of bugs they have here. And it's just, not interested in all that. So the humidity drives me crazy. I'm coming into my favorite time of year, fall and then winter. To me, it's magic time. Air is clear. Think sharp. You make things that are sharp. You just, it's just, I'm more alive. In the summer, it's okay. It's good. But I don't like canned air, the air conditioning. Don't care for that at all. I'd rather natural air for me is the way to go.
Oh, that's so funny. How many studies do you do before you, I mean, so 30 by 30 is like your kind of your
starting point.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. In a series, when I'm working on a series, right, I did a series, a nocturne series of this one tree. And because I had painted, it was the same tree. You know, you make the moves. It's like very much like a Chinese brush artist. It's like you learn the marks. You know how to make, I could paint that motif blindfolded in turn. I mean, I blindfold, but I don't need to look at anything to make that painting now because I own it now because it's here and it's in my heart. It's in my arm and hands. So sometimes when I'm working on a series, I may not do any small studies. I just jump into the larger paintings.
So wait, that's because you've spent so much time out there. It's not necessarily about...
If I've done one, that could be the leaping off point for all of them.
Okay.
Because I understand where I'm going with it. And I also like not knowing where I'm going sometimes. I like the adventure of, oh my gosh, I may have just screwed this up. And I like, that doesn't scare me. You see, that's another thing. A lot of artists are afraid. It's like, afraid to make a mistake or have failure. It's like, what's wrong? I mean, there's no such thing as failure in painting.
Right.
You put them off to the side, you learn, you let it dry, and you do something on top of that.
Right. You're not a heart surgeon. You're not, yeah, nobody's.
Yeah. No one's falling out of the sky. No one's, exactly. So, and I love working on failed paintings over them because, you know, the first mark that you make on a, like I did these two paintings that were 60 inches high by 72. So it's 5 by 6 feet. Didn't like them. I didn't like what I was doing with them. Put them aside. Then I started to do this. I wanted to do the series of paintings, part of the White Pine Suite called the gates section. So it was two apple trees because the apple trees, you have to go through apple trees to get to the White Pine Forest. So these gates were, one was a tree that was now a dead tree, but I got it in springtime where all these vines were growing on it and there's lichen on it and all this stuff. So it's supporting life without being alive. It's kind of interesting thing. So that I did on top of that. So I started it, and this painting, because of the size of it, I didn't use anything smaller than a 1-inch brush for the smallest detail. And that I used the side of it, but a lot of 3-inch brushes to make this painting. And then the other one was an apple tree in blossom. So you have an old tree and a young tree. And those were both over paintings that were not, didn't go.
Right.
So And I like that. That first mark you make on another painting, it's like, ooh, where am I going here? It's like, and then some of that infuses, some of that color informs new color choices
that
you normally would think of.
So, yeah, I want to ask you about that because I do that too. And if I don't think about it too much, it doesn't bother me at all to paint on top of another painting. I just go for it.
Right, exactly.
But then if I start thinking about it too much, then I
don't think about it.
Stop thinking.
Feel. Think about, you got to think about what you want to do.
Well, because of the whole color issue, when you put a color down and it's over another, an old painting that has nothing to do with where you're going now,
that's right.
Those colors are informing those colors.
And that first mark you put, it's like jumping out of an airplane and saying, oh, did I put the parachute on? I don't even know yet. You have to, oh yeah, it's there. And then you can know you can go. And that's, and it takes, it, it's not the first one. It takes a couple of hours to tangle that beast. I mean, to tame that, because it's like, you've got this stuff and you got to get harmonies going. And then it's like, but you make it work. Scumbling, you get to, and what I like is you get to the good stuff right away, as opposed to building it up new.
Because you have all that texture underneath from the old painting.
Right. So you can dry brush right away and make new statements. Painting is, oh my gosh, it's a vocabulary that I absolutely enjoy. It's very hard to talk about this to artists. A lot of artists, everybody has their own process, and some people are very pure in how they do it, and I don't understand that, but that's not me.
Right.
And there's very few painters I talk to who get what I'm saying here about working, reworking, and abrading a surface, and literally driving it, you know, torturing the surface, and then seeing how far you can push something, and then take it back. So I enjoy that. That to me is the fun part.
Yeah, it's interesting. You're making me think about it because what I'm thinking about is I just have these brand new panels and I'm afraid of them. It's so much easier for me to just take a crappy painting and then pull something out of that. And I have fun and I'm way more relaxed and it's exciting and all that.
And a lot of times with a new surface, the first thing I do is just start making marks. Just divisions of marks, big, you know, like where things could be, and not think about them in any way as finished, or not even finished, not even real, just in terms of making something to get rid of it. I learned that as an illustrator. The white surface always killed me. So I always threw something up on there to pull it together. So that the first mark I made had something to relate to, because on white, everything is dark. Everything on white, even, oh, you remember, you two must have at Art Center, you had to take a watercolor class. I'm sure you did. Did you?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Okay. I remember Pratt when I went, I remember it was a watercolor class. It was all guys in the class. And he said, okay, I want you to get a sheet of Arches watercolor paper, 140 cold press.
That's expensive stuff.
So back then it was like 97 cents. But you want to know something? My daily bus ticket into the city and lunch was a $5 round. Everything was $5. Mm-hmm. So I was... So 1/5 of that went to a piece of paper. So in the class, because, okay, gentlemen, you've taken this dollar sheet of paper. The first mark you make, it's worthless. Now, the second and third and the rest of the marks you make elevate the price. And that's what you got to do. You got to make it be something. And those first marks on watercolor are very tentative because we're afraid. It's like, oh, I got to put, I'm putting down the lights. But if you don't put them down dark enough, you don't have a statement. You have what I call little old lady watercolors. Everything is bleached out. And it's because the first mark you make looks so dark and you're afraid to go darker. But really, a yellow ochre out of the tube is like a value 3 or 4. Mm-hmm. That could be your lightest value in the whole painting. It could be. It depends on what you do around it. Everything, like color, you learn that from the Albers exercises, that color has, it's only matters about when it has a relative space to be in. So yellow ochre could be dark or it could be light, but it depends what you do with it. So those are the things, that's what I love about color. Color is infinite.
So exciting.
It is, isn't it? It's an infinite subject to play with forever. And it's like something like you don't come to an end.
Right.
No, the painters, it's like Renoir. Renoir on his deathbed said, I think I'm getting a handle on this, you know? It's kind of true. It's like you're always going to – and the best thing about painting is the next painting is the best painting. It's going to be the best painting, mm-hmm. the next one. Because mm-hmm. if it wasn't that way, you wouldn't pick up a brush again. If you fell in love with a painting so much that you're afraid to paint again, what is the point of that? That is nuts. And people do that. And maybe I've never made anything that good. But the point is, I think the next one is coming.
Yeah.
I've always believed that.
Yeah.
I always believe that. What's over there? What's that going to be?
For the eternal optimists.
Yeah, well, that's it. You get you. No one needs another painting. No one needs another artist to make a painting. No one needs it. But you have to make the person want a painting. You know, wanting something is very different than needing something. The want, that desire gets in there and you want it. And that's what I hope I can elicit in some, the people that collect my work. Because those are the things I find important, is that other people respond. Not just because it's nice. I want somebody that can feel something.
Mm-hmm.
They feel it. I know I've connected with people. That's what's exciting. And it's fair because not everybody gets it that on that level. People can respond to it as a beautiful piece, but they don't necessarily connect it on an emotional level other than it's a beautiful piece, which can be quite moving. But people who get the thing that I've been talking about, the spiritual part and the color and all, those people are rare, but they exist and they do understand. And that, to me, has been really worthwhile.
Mm-hmm.
And none of them are ever family.
Mm-hmm.
My wife and my kids get it. Both my kids went to art school. They went to School of Visual Arts, where I teach.
Uh-huh.
And they're making their way in the art world. And my wife is a sculptor. So, you know, we're all very supportive of each other. So it's a pretty good environment. It's good.
I think that's really important because you're just constantly surrounded by art and artists.
Yes, that's right.
And people creating.
Right. There's no one who lives here around us except us. So we're it. Kids are now, my daughter is in LA. My son is in Brooklyn. And they're doing, and it's just wonderful to see it.
One of the questions I like to ask, and it's kind of, now it's completely loaded question because of what you just told me, but what advice do you give to your sons and daughters about being an artist?
Well, the same advice that I tell my students at school, and something my dad told me about life and being happy in life. And the two things he told me, and I was a little kid, randomly why he told me this, I have no idea at the age he did, but I was very young. And he said, Peter, there are two things in life that people have regrets over at the end of their life. And he told me, and two of them were never taking a chance or never giving your dream a shot. Never trying because you're fearful of that or let someone else say no to you, right? And that's true. He never said I had to succeed. I just had to give myself the chance.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you know, if you honestly give yourself a chance, you've satisfied that. Because you know you can or you can't. The point is, you've tried. If you never do, and it's always in you that I could have, I should have, I wasted my life or I wasted my time, that'll eat you up.
Mm-hmm.
That'll eat you up. And the other one is spending more time with the people you love and the people that love you. And I tell that to my students because that is, other than becoming an artist and a painter, that goes to everybody in this world, whatever it is you want to be. So art just happens to be art. It just happens to be another way of making something or doing something in life, being something, a part of our society. Now, the students that I tell them, you have to understand, you have to make, like I just said before, you have to make things that people respond to. Now, you just can't paint for fashion's sake, meaning, oh, this guy's hot. Oh, this is happening now. There's a thing going on in the art world now that I don't understand. Somebody came up with the idea of painting figures where faces are all broken up and moving around. It's like, right? And I'm saying, there's so many people doing that. I said, does that really everybody speak? That speaks to the same thing in everybody, or is that fashion?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's fashion because that's a hot thing. You know what I'm saying?
I know exactly the kind of paintings you're talking about. I'm kind of curious. I don't know the answer to this, and I haven't honestly thought about it so much. But I think there's some paintings that you see like that, that they're obviously responding to and trying to paint like Alex Konevsky somebody like that, right? Somebody who's...
There's one Alex Konevsky.
Yeah, and nobody
there's
can...
one.
And there can only be one, and there only should be one.
That's right. That's his vision. He came to that for a reason.
Yeah.
They can't possibly have the same reason.
No. But I also think there are some people who, I mean, I feel like you can tell when somebody's copying somebody else. There's just no energy in it. It's too calculated.
Well, that's what I'm talking about. It's just surface.
Yeah. But I think also people have been so exposed to, you know, like people, artists now, like we see things that no other artist has seen before, in the sense that the world we live in, technology, I think video games, television, movies.
It informs everything.
Yes.
And a lot of it looks like it's that kind of thing. Like some of that painting always reminded me of like do you remember a TV show that was going to be the new look, the new idea of what video was going to be? Remember Max Headroom?
Yes.
You remember that?
Yes.
Okay. Now, you remember that when he spoke, things were like stutter shake, and it was like, okay, that's what the painting looks like to me. It has those kinds of issues. It's like, it's almost like a digitized world done two-dimensionally in a sense of multiple layered things. And if it's done for that reasoning, I get it. But
a lot of it's not. You're right.
Exactly. It's a lot of it's copy.
Right.
And I know that because as an illustrator, I was very aware of who the guys led the world and who was copying who, just for the sake of copying. And that's, I don't want to be that.
Right.
I don't want to be that guy.
Right.
What's the point? It's so hard to copy. Why not just be yourself? That's just as hard.
It's harder. I think that's why they copy.
It's harder because you can't, to be a copy, At the very best, you're second rate. At the very best, you're second rate.
Mm-hmm. And even then, you're not honoring who, you know, I hear so many artists talk about wanting to be authentic and wanting to find their voice and et cetera, et cetera. And I think you have to, I mean, I think it is important to understand other painters and to understand their influences, et cetera, but it's, you know, like you have your own unique thumbprint and that's what makes you an interesting artist. And if you try to imitate somebody else's thumbprint, yeah, it's...
You can't do it.
Yeah, it's fake.
Oh, I don't understand why you would want to. I don't understand that.
I think, honestly, I think people do it because they're scared.
You got to make a living. Part of that.
Part of it is making a living. But I think if they were only interested in making a living, they would choose something other than art. You know, if they were only interested in money. So I think, you know, the deeper reason is that they're afraid to be themselves. That they're like, it's too vulnerable to.
And, you know, and I got to say, as being teaching in the classroom, It's interesting how people who are seniors in college are still like freshmen in high school, in a sense that they're afraid to speak out. They're afraid to say things for fear of being judged by the other people in the room. And I always tell them, you know, being an artist, you have to learn how to speak. You have to learn how to do all of that. And you can't, and you really can't worry about how other people feel about things. I'm not saying you step on people intentionally. I'm not saying that at all. But you have to be able to just talk about your work and defend your work and talk about that. And no, it took me a while to learn that because when I got out of Pratt, well, this is going to sound great, but at Pratt, I was one of those kids where it was like, oh, don't call me. Jeez, don't call on me. Don't call on me. I can't talk about it. I would talk about my work. I would even rip apart my work, but I would never do that about someone else's work. I could never do that because I didn't feel comfortable making someone feel whatever, you know? So I just don't call on me. Wasn't good. So when I got out of school, I was very close to the chairman of the department, and he said, you know, you're not going to be a complete artist unless you can really talk about these kinds of things. So at the age of 21, he gave me a sophomore class to teach, an illustration class. And let me tell you something. I must have been the world's worst teacher that first semester.
Of course you were.
Absolutely. And I tell you, it was crazy but then I did realize that if I didn't start talking, nothing was going to happen in this room. Mm-hmm. And that's what it taught me. It taught me how to control, how to voice things, and how to speak about things. And I learned how to critique things without hurting someone's feelings. I don't say, this is terrible, don't do this. I never say that. I'll say, there's always something in a piece that has merit, even if it's just a small area of something. I'll talk about why it is, why that works, what's good about that. Do more of this. Try to enhance this, make these other elements that are not as strong support that. And then I'll talk about compositional things and all that. And I get more favorable things from students when I speak that way, rather than tear someone down. There are teachers who tear people down, mm-hmm. and kids cry, mm-hmm. but they do learn, and they learn there too. So it's like, but that's not me. I just don't want to do that to people. Never could. I can't do that.
Well, I think I think that everybody has their own personality and their own way of doing it. And just now, as I'm saying that, like, I'm having this voice in my head of
who is it? Who was it that said this to you?
I think that what you were, you know, where we were originally talking about, I think it's really important that you said that first class that you taught, you thought you were the world's worst teacher or whatever. But
oh, I know. I don't think I know. It was.
Well, the thing, I mean, and that's the thing is we have these crazy expectations, I think, that the first time that we do anything, that we're going to be really successful for it. And the first time is practice for the second time that you did it.
Yes. Well, that's what painting is. Mm-hmm. Painting is, a lot of people are afraid to make marks. They're afraid of making it because it's like, oh, this is the worst. It's like students that come in with a canvas that's a $30 canvas or whatever, and they're afraid to paint because mm-hmm. it's so pretty. I go, it's not pretty. It's just a blank spur. Whether you work on a piece of gesso paper, that gesso paper, you probably would attack that much more freely and make something much more interesting on that than you'll ever do on that canvas because you're afraid you're going to destroy that canvas. On this gesso paper, you got what? About $1 invested on that? This you'll do all day long and you'll have a lot more growth over here. So I tell them, I have my students in class work on Frederick's canvas pads. Because there's 10 sheets, they're cotton duct, they're gessoed, and it like $1, $2 a sheet. Oh, much more freedom. Mm-hmm. I get much more free stuff out of that. As soon as I tell them to bring in a canvas, it's like they're afraid. Oh, they're very afraid. They make the same tentative mark. You know, it's like everybody has that mark.
Yeah. How do they get past that, or do they? Like by the time they're fourth year
students. Our department, the illustration department, is very much a fine art sensate now. Illustration, because we do have a lot of students that do illustrative kind of things. Most of that is digital. A lot of that is coming out digitally now. But in the same major, we have people working traditional mediums. And traditional mediums are much more painters. And their interests may be illustration, but I think it's more going toward a gallery world right now. And the reason they're there is because of the representational training. Mm-hmm. That they're interested as opposed to the fine art departments. Fine art departments have their own thing going. It's a little different, obviously. So, yeah, there's just people have always gravitated toward the illustration departments for the practicality of learning how to make something.
Right, right.
Right. And this ends on with that.
Yeah. I think for me, I was interested in the figure, and the illustration department at that time had, you know, 5 days a week.
Right.
You spent probably three or four of those in front of the figure.
Right. I'm sure you had something as special as a head painting class.
Oh, yeah. We had head painting, head drawing. We had, I think there was even a class on just hands. I mean,
right.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, absolutely. Well, that's the illustrator's Bible, heads, hands, and body. You'd need to have all that. Absolutely. Hands are expressive. You got to be able to do those. You can't tuck them behind things all the time.
Yeah. You just reminded me of like, there was this, I think it was a cartoon or something about, you know, or a series of images of people who can't draw hands or feet. And they were always ingeniously hidden by, you know, a rock or a fold or something.
Yeah. I had an instructor, David Pasalacqua, who was an outrageous instructor. He never taught me anything specifically except the energy and desire to be an artist, which is amazing. Like, he had a fire in him about that. But he would scream when we were drawing. It was an illustration class. Every week we had you give an assignment. The next week would be we would draw in class, and the assignment would be to the next week. So every other week, 1 week was drawing and 1 week was critique. Now, the drawing week, he would just get on our cases about drawing hands, draw hands, draw hands. He goes, those of you who are hiding those hands, the first job you're going to get is a pair of hands, and you don't even know what the hell they look like. And he was not wrong. I mean, you got to be able to do that. They're not just like, you know,
little sausages.
That's right. That's right. The illustration department at my school at the time didn't have a lot of painting. It was mostly a lot of the illustrators who taught there were draftsmen, like pen and ink, or they would draw and then use dyes or watercolor or whatever. So the painting classes I had were in the fine art department. And I tell you, the brush, the idea of using a brush, this stick with hairs at the end, was the most impractical way to make something. I could draw with chalk. I could draw with pencil, anything. Mm-hmm. Even I remember we used to take celery sticks with ink and dip them in dry. I could do that. But this brush, it was like this odd tool, and I could not figure that out. It took me years. But I learned how to paint by using pastels. And then I was able to remember going back to colorate paper, not making color, but selecting color. That's what pastels did for me. So I went out and bought the biggest set of pastels that were made at that time. And at that time, Grumbacher made a set of 1,000 sticks. And it was like, oh my God, it was like 8 trays with all these things. It was like every color you could imagine, spectrum, value, and then earth tones, all values from tints to shade, all the way through. So when I'd lay them out, I'd put the trays in chromatic order or whatever, and I didn't have to think about how to make a color. It was now selecting color.
That would just be like, so I skipped over the whole pastel thing, I guess, or I just never went there. But that would be like information overload for me. I would know, like, I wouldn't know what, I would totally freeze.
But I didn't have any, I had no idea how to make or mix color.
Right.
Didn't have no clue. I knew basics, but I didn't understand tertiary colors and nuance, gray greens. How do you get that? I have no idea.
Right.
You know, opaque, no opaque, opacity. So I did it with pastel, and I would always mingle color. If I wanted a lavender, I could put a blue with a pink, and then little flecks of orange, a little bit of green to make those things exciting. And I did that in pastel. And then if you look at my paintings today, it's the way I paint. Like, I'll send you a couple of shots, close-ups of a painting I did that is 60 by 84 inches of this tree. And I'm just going to give you the chromatic sections of leaves and trees.
Oh, cool.
You're going to see this, and you're going to say, that's a pastel. Could look like a pastel painting, because that's how I paint. I do blend, but I do a lot of mingling and layering of color, dry brush, and a lot of edges and touches and things. So it's very much the pastel sensate for me, but dries, so it's safe.
Yeah. Very important.
Doesn't fall off. Right. Doesn't fall off.
You don't need a big, exactly, you know, 6-foot thing of glass in front of it.
That's right.
I think that's so interesting what you just said, though, that it just kind of goes again to that whole concept of there is no other Peter Fiore.
That's right.
It's absolutely impossible, because those little habits that you got from your art school because you happened to take this class, or you happened to find that 1,000 pastel Grumbacher thing.
That's right. And this is the thing. You have to believe And this is because I didn't learn about value structure. I always knew that intuitively I would get there somehow, but I would have to, like, I remember in school, I'd be make a painting and like change the sky six times to get the right value and color because I didn't calculate it up here. I didn't do that first. I didn't understand that. So I just knew that I knew I would get there because it would feel right when I did. And I had, because I always trusted my eye and trusted my ability to understand what I was seeing. And I knew I would just stumble through things and I would get there. And that's, painting is very much still like that. There's no formulaic way of painting for me. It's like I'll do some paintings, you know, I'll do two or three paintings and now I have to mix up how I start a painting. Like some days I'll start on a white ground and some days I'll throw down a pink tone. Or some days I'll throw down a gray tone, or someday I'll put down a vibrant lavender and I'll work on top of that. Or but you think about what I'm doing here. It's like pastel sheets of paper, which is what I used to do years ago.
That makes sense.
And sometimes now, because it's paint, I can do part of it one color. I could do another part another color, which has nothing to do with what's going over it in a sense. It's just something for me to hang and the energy on and build.
Right.
So it could be, and I also start paintings with big, big, big fan brushes, like Badger fan brushes, because they allow, and I don't use them to blend color. I use them to paint with because they can move and make all kinds of marks.
Uh-huh.
See, fan brushes, I don't use them to blend or bring things together. I use them to paint, apply lots of paint with.
Really? Do you get like big, thick chunks of paint on there? Wow.
Rosemary brushes. You know rosemary brushes?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. She makes these Badger brushes, fan brushes, which I bought the large one because large in most sizes are like, you know, they're like that, you know, like that kind of a fan.
So like 3 inches across or something.
Not even, not even. Like that's like, if you used to get mongoose hair brushes, that's what they'd be.
Right.
This comes, it was like that. It was like this. It was like ridiculous. It was like 6 inches across and about, you know, like a half inch thick. And it was like, well, this is going to be interesting, but good paint for big paintings. They're terrific.
Uh-huh.
They're really good. They move a lot of paint. And if you work on a panel, they slide and you can throw some medium in there or some solvent and you get these thunderous marks right from the very beginning. And then you scrape them, you do whatever you got to do and react to it.
Right.
The reacting to painting, you make a mark and react. You make a mark and react. You make a mark and react. That's painting. And if you do that and build and with an idea of something in mind, a painting emerges.
Mm-hmm.
That's the best part. And that is the best part, is not knowing how I'm going to do the painting.
Mm-hmm.
If I know exactly how it's going to come out, it's kind of a boring process for me. And it's like, and if I'm not entertained, I don't think the viewer is.
Right.
So if I'm entertained and it's exciting for me, I think it's exciting for somebody else.
Yeah.
You know, so there's a lot of stuff I've talked about here that could infuriate some people, maybe. But you know what? That's why I said earlier, it's my process.
Exactly.
I'm not saying everybody's process because nothing is everybody's, and I'm not even pretending that it is. This is what works for me.
Mm-hmm.
But I've always made big decisions quickly. Like little stupid things, like what do I want for lunch is harder than like I'm going to buy a car today, or I'm going to do this painting this way today. I don't sit there for a month and what am I going to do? I just get started and then I'll make the painting. And then if it doesn't work, do another one. What's the big, you know, that's why you have racks in the studio to put them away, let them dry and pull them out and turn them upside down or not, tack them again. And I never white out the surface. I never paint over it again that way. I will always paint on it as paint.
Uh-huh.
And that's another thing. So, you know, how a lot of artists, you know, I don't wait for inspiration. There's not something, you just go to the studio every day. The inspiration comes from going every single day and you're out there. And it's like, if you don't make anything, you know, that's why I have lots of paintings going, because when I get out to the studio, you know, you think when you're leaving the house, walking to the studio, I'm going to do this. But you get in there for whatever reason, it's like your frame of mind or a mood changes or something. So it's like I have paintings at all different stages. I have canvases that are blanks. I have paintings that are halfway, paintings that are just started, paintings that are buttoning up. And that way, whatever I'm doing, I match my mood to the paint, or match the painting to my mood. How's that? That way, I'm in tune with the surface I'm working on, because I don't want to force something when I'm not feeling that.
Right. That's huge. And I think a lot of people don't realize that.
That is big. That's something that I taught myself because of so many paintings. I just kind of like, oh, I could do this one now, or I could do that one now. Sometimes you go out there and you just want to like be like a dog gnawing on a bone, like you work on a small area or whatever. And that's a lot of layering and dry brushing and scraping. You just do that. Some days you just want to work very big with a brush and move it around. Mm-hmm. And if you don't feel like that and the painting's not ready to do that, you're in trouble. At least I am. Mm-hmm. I have to have it all in sync. Then I have the right music for all of that. Like I wouldn't listen to Beethoven for the noodling or the sitting down. No, it becomes very different. Maybe some sonatas or something like that, violin music, something. But yeah, it depends. And that's, you know, this is life and art. To me, it's all this, you know, it's like.
Absolutely.
Cooking, all of that to me is like right here. And, you know, you even talked about some of the questions you had about books and all that. It's like, I read very little fiction. I read a lot of history, but I also read a lot about other artists. When I read about artists, I don't care. I'm not interested in how they made things. I want to know why they make things. The whys are more important to me mm-hmm. than how anything is done. I figured out how to make things for me. I want to know why. That's like when I read, like I just was rereading a book, a biography on Beethoven. It's like the whys of this music, the why.
Mm-hmm.
And those are eternal things. Because being human in the early 18th century, is just as human as today. We just have a different sort of prism to look at it. But humanity is the same thing. It's always the same thing. It's about fear. It's about conquering. It's about love. It's about purpose. That's what people want in life, purpose.
Mm-hmm.
And being appreciated and loved. And when those things don't happen, they affect how you feel about things and work. And that was Beethoven. He had a lot of professional great successes. His personal life was crazy. It was like he didn't have that. So that fueled a lot of things. It's like when I listen to music, for instance, like I love Beethoven hugely, very passionate. I like Mozart, but Mozart, to me, they always say the perfect. That you look at his original manuscripts, they're perfect. And because he was very much an intellectual writer and mm-hmm. he could write that. And he lived to be what, 33 years old or something like that. But his experiences in life and what he wrote was from the experience of a 33-year-old man at the latest. And that's a young person's life,
mm-hmm.
right? You can imagine beyond it, you haven't lived it. Now you look at Beethoven's life. The pain and anguish that he went through reflects in his music. You look at his score, an original score written by Beethoven, the most tortured soul you've ever seen. Rewrites, thinking it over, ripping sections, pasting. And it's like his music feels that way. It resonates deeper in me. And that's the kind of painting that I like. Mm-hmm. I want paintings that resonate with people that have that sense of resonance.
I'm kind of curious as I'm thinking about it, because what that brings up is this theory that I think comes up a lot with art is that you have to suffer for your art, that you have to have this long anguished life. And I'm kind of wondering if it's more that Beethoven thought deeper.
That's it. He went deeper. He had an emotional cord that he hit that most people don't allow themselves to feel. And he let that become a fuel for himself. Now, that doesn't mean you have to live an anguished life, but it means I think you have to be passionate, deeply passionate about what you do, as opposed to, oh, that's nice. That looks good. I'll do that. Or there's two, three trees. I'll paint that. That's an interesting composition because it hits the rules. Well, I don't like the rules because the rules make – if you paint everything by the rules, we all paint by the rules. Pretty soon we're putting ourselves to sleep.
Yeah, and we're all painting the same paintings.
Right. So I like – you know, in school, you don't put something in there. Well, that's what I do. I like to put things right in the middle. I like to put something in the middle with the horizon right in the middle of the canvas. Now work like hell to make that painting interesting, meaning the light, the shapes, the shadows, all of that to energize that surface. Well, that's what it takes to do.
I'm just laughing because it just sounds like things that I do, and the response that I get from people a lot of times is, man, you love to make your life so difficult. You start everything the hard way.
Yeah, I do too. And that's true.
I like a good challenge.
Challenges are what allow creativity to succeed. If you're not challenged, what's the sense of accomplishment? that you made. I did another one. That's like putting out ice cream cones or ice creams, you know, sundaes. Well, that's delicious. Oh, this is delicious. Pretty soon you get sick of that in a while. Pretty soon I just want to eat a cheese sandwich. Or, you know what I mean? It's like, that's what I'm talking about. It's like, it has to be something that means something to you. It just can't be over and over the same thing over and over. Even though I paint trees, people say you paint trees. Yeah, I do paint trees. But my trees are not just trees. You got to look at them, really look at them. And when they do, they get that. They understand that. And that's what's good.
Yeah. You can tell immediately when I see your paintings that you know how trees are and you've spent a lot of time with them. And it's not just a flip kind of a – it's – I think some paintings feel like the equivalent of, you know, like just going on vacation, going to the obligatory spots that you're supposed to go to. Like if you go to Italy, for example, you go and you snap the picture.
Well, that's what I call looking for the tripod holes to put your tripod in where the other photographers have been. So this is the sanctioned spot. This is where you get it.
Right.
Right here. This is the shot to take.
Right.
Oh, yeah. It was a very, you know, this is a good point. Years ago, Barbara and I were, I think it was early 2001 in May. We were in Tuscany driving and we're on the back roads. And we come across, and the Val d'Oci is a quintessential little chapel you've seen photographed a bazillion times in the distance with the cypress trees and that one particular building. It's like ubiquitous. It's everywhere. So we were looking for it just as a joke and we never could find it. And then all of a sudden I said, I'm going to try this road. We go down this road. Sure enough, I see it. We get there. There's got to be like 20 photographers with big Canon lenses, white lenses. They're all lined up. Boom, 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 boom. And from the road, I took a picture of them taking a picture of that. And it was like, that was to me more interesting than the picture of what they were taking.
Right.
Because it's like, that's the sanctioned shot. Well, this is the one that you don't see.
Right.
You know, it's like, and then it's like the same thing when I went to the Louvre to see the, we went and then I remember getting into the room with the Mona Lisa, for instance.
Oh.
It's like everybody's lined up for this thing.
It's the mob scene.
It's ridiculous. And this is the best part. So those two parts. The interesting part was everybody's got their cell phones up, right? So I got this great shot of, in the distance, you can see the Mona Lisa, but all these variations of her on these different cell phones.
Oh,
and then, so that's an interesting shot. And then on the wall behind, right opposite the painting, no one is looking at perhaps Leonardo's one of his best paintings, Virgin on the Rocks, is right there. And no one's looking at it. And I was like, that's a far better painting than the Mona Lisa.
Right.
And this one's got like, you know, Mona Lisa's got like 50 people deep and you can't even get anywhere near it. And it's only like, you know, it's like a 16 by 20 or 20 by 16.
It's so small. I couldn't believe how small it is. Yeah. I had that exact same experience with The Birth of Venus, the Botticelli. I mean, it was like a madhouse in front of it. And people were like, you know, like,
oh, yeah.
I was just like, God, I can't even stand this.
I know. It's, yeah. Yeah. Museums sometimes are great and sometimes they're really frustrating.
Yeah.
Yeah. And all in all, you know, if I think about a life, it's like choices you make. You know, my very first memory. And this came about from, I didn't ever thought about it till I was being interviewed for a magazine article. A guy wanted me to talk about something early in life. And I was talking about my first memory. And my first memory was when I was 15 months old, my brother was born and he's home. And I remember him in a bassinet on a dining room table. And I remember the light of the chandelier shining down, hitting the white tablecloth. My grandmother ironing with her white hair, silver hair was lit up. And my first memory is about light. So it's sort of like an interesting thing how that permeates, that, you know, there are things that innately, that's who you are. I was very lucky that I found a trigger that tripped me up early, that got into my brain early. And I was always looking at things like that. My mother used to always, you know, watch me open the blinds in her bedroom when I was like 4 or 5, because the sunlight would come in the afternoon and I'd watch it race across the floor, up the bed, across the bed sheet, and up the wall. And I used to always run to do it at that time because it was exciting.
Yeah.
And it would go away. And it's like, I didn't understand why it went away. Then I learned, well, the sun sets, it moves. You didn't know that as a little kid. So you learn, and it's like all of that. And then going to art school, it was a choice. I went to an academic high school. It did very, very, very well. And I thought maybe science, something like that. And then it really came down to, you know, I didn't want to carry a textbook around anymore. I enjoyed the photography a lot. I enjoyed pictures a lot. So that's what I wanted to do. I said, that would be, this is just, I didn't know if I'd make a living at it.
Right.
But, you know, it wasn't difficult to succeed only because I came from a poor family. I didn't have to make a lot, a big living to be successful. All I had to do was able to support myself so I could live somewhere. And I worked hard. I worked very hard as an illustration student to start. And that's how it started. The discipline of doing the homework and doing all of the work. That started Catholic school. Catholic school, you don't get to go to school without your homework. The nuns would kill you. So when I went to Pratt, the very first day, now I'm in an art school in New York City, and I have five friends. One other guy went to Catholic school, and we have our first assignments due. It's a drawing. And I put mine up, and my friend Mike, he went to Catholic school, he put his up, and my friend Corey, Mike, another Mike, and Ed didn't have anything to go up. And I'm thinking, where's your homework? Oh, we didn't finish it. And it would never dawn on me not to have the homework. And, well, when I was a kid, it was fear of death.
Right.
Fear of death.
And then it became fear of rulers.
Fear of rulers, right. Then it became fear of rulers. And in art school, it was just fear of not succeeding.
Yeah.
And then I knew I would succeed. I never had a doubt I would succeed. I never had a doubt that I would. And my goal was to be published before I got out of school because I wanted that as a mark that I could make it in this industry. Because illustration in those days, and it still is illustration, is not rocket science. It's like, look at the client, look at what they do, and build a portfolio toward that if that's what you want to do. Give them samples of what they already use. And if you do it at the same level, everybody wants to find a young person to do, to work with, to discover and all of that. And that's exactly what happened. I remember putting together a mailer, you know, like a sheet to mail out work mm-hmm. with five paintings. I only knew five magazines to send it to. I had 1,000 of these things. I mailed them on a Friday afternoon. Monday morning, I got the call from McCall's magazine, bring your portfolio in. So I bring in the portfolio. I didn't even have it reproduced in any way. I had original paintings. I had them in a case. So I bring the paintings, takes three of them, goes down the hallway, comes back with my paintings, and he hands me what looks like a term paper. And I didn't know what it was. I go, I'm looking, I have no clue. It's a manuscript, my first manuscript to do. Because it looked like what I would hand into as an assignment, mm-hmm. you know, title. And I had no idea what that was. And that's how I got started. And then the career took off and that supported me. And illustration taught me how to paint.
Mm-hmm. And hit deadlines,
paint, discipline. And then every illustration job I did, I pushed it to try something different. Backlighting, side lighting, you know, soft. Whenever I could do that, try something I never did before. Mm. And that way I was being paid decently to learn how to paint. So that was a good thing for me, that part of that career.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
But, you know, the one regret I do have is that I should have walked away from illustration sooner. But it was difficult. I was raising a family, and I needed to make a certain living. But the teaching now in the last 27 years or so has stabilized all that. So now with the teaching and the selling of paintings, I'm okay. It's good. I teach a couple of classes a week, a few classes a week, and I call it the grant. It's like my yearly grant. But I do teach.
Yeah.
But it's like I get the opportunity to do the kind of things I want to do.
Yeah.
I don't have to paint for a commercial market.
Right. And I think that's really important. I think that's another thing that is misunderstood often, is that your teaching job is sort of your patron. It makes sure your bills are paid. And
that's right. That's right. My medical, the whole thing, right?
Yeah. And I think that there's this misconception that you're not a real artist until you make 100% of your living off of selling your paintings. And I have not, I think I've interviewed like one person out of like the hundreds of interviews that I've done.
Right, right, right.
That's not how it's done.
Bert Silver. My God, I met him. And he was illustrating. He used to illustrate.
I heard he did the Jethro Tull. Yes.
He did Aqualung.
Yes.
He did a lot of time covers. He did Reader's Digest magazines. He did condensed books. He did commercial art too. But he was the guy I looked at because he did it as a painter. He didn't follow fashion. He was still doing what he did, and he made it work commercially. He's a good man.
Yes. Very, very funny too. Wonderful person.
I met him once. I just met him once. I enjoyed that.
I've only seen him as I'm seeing you.
Okay. All right. That must have been a great interview. I got to watch. I watched part of it. I have to watch the second part.
It was great. He was so much fun.
Wise man. Been around a long time. And that's another thing, that the one thing about painting is that maturity brings another level of things. Just like we were talking about Beethoven with the music. As you get older, things resonate. Things that resonate now in me, I never felt before. I understood them intellectually. I feel it now. I can feel that now. And it just means more now when you feel it or when you have experienced it. Because now it's part of who you are, or a part of who you are that you want to expose.
Yeah. Yeah. Or you have an idea that you want to play out and see.
Yeah. The spiritual part of all of this is huge to me, because it's an amazing thing. You know, it's like this world that we're in, whatever it is, you know, if you think about this craziness of that, we're this little planet at this distance from the sun that allows life to exist here. However that is and why that is, I don't know. I don't pretend to know, don't want to really know. But the point is, it's just that it is. And it's enough to know that it is. That's exciting, because that's all we have. You know, and it's exciting to get up and look at it and be able to be a part of this and affect and capture parts of this. That's what's so exciting to me.
Yeah.
To be vital in it. It's a gift to be able to have that. And it's not the gift of being able to draw. There's so many people could draw better than me. So many people could paint better than me. It's just that you have to have a point of view and a purpose and an attitude. And that's what makes the art. Is that need to communicate.
Mm-hmm.
And I've always enjoyed that. Hopefully I will. I've taken a lot of your time. I can go on and on.
I can too, trust me. But Peter, this has been a wonderful conversation, and I'm so glad that we got to talk.
I hope you have something to put here. I hope you can get an hour out of this.
Oh, of course I can. A big thank you to Peter for a fabulous conversation about art. Go to savvypainter.com/podcast for show notes on this episode. You'll get links to everything that we talked about, and you can check out his tree paintings. They are wonderful. You'll see the results of his years of study, and the light is magnificent. Savvy Painter, Gamblin Artist Colors, and Trakel Art Supplies are teaming up together to do our first online art competition. Artist Carol Marine will be jurying the show. You might remember that Carol was a guest on The Savvy Painter. She's a painter herself and the founder of dailypaintworks.com. First place winner will receive $500 in merchandise from both Gamblin and Trakel, plus a cash prize of $250. But that's not all. The first place winner will also be a guest on the Savvy Painter podcast. So if you win first prize, you get your work in front of tens of thousands of people, $1,000 worth of art supplies to paint to your heart's content, and some cold hard cash. Entries are being accepted from now until October 29th, 2017. Go to savvypainter.com and click on the Call to Entries tab for more information. I can't wait to see the great work that you submit. Good luck. Now, I'd like to take a moment to thank some of you who have supported the podcast. The Savvy Painter podcast is made possible in part by listeners like you. Much gratitude goes out to each and every one of you who contribute. For some people, it's a couple bucks a week. Others, it's easier to give in a lump sum. Whichever it is, however much, every bit helps. And I am so, so grateful for your support. So a big thank you to Denny Holland, Victoria Cotton, Jeanette Stoll, Astrid Fitzgerald, Ed Penniman, Kenneth Burke, Don Chandler, Lynn Mehta, Bettina Davis, Bruce Garrity, Winslow Arts Center, Stephanie Neely, Melissa Nolan, Shirley Williams, Psychodynamic Yoga, the lovely Renee Bates, Jennifer Lessman, Elizabeth Quinn Bolduck, Carolyn Green, and David Gorski. Thank you so much for your support. Until next week, this is Antrice Wood with the Savvy Painter podcast. Thank you so much for listening.